promises. It seems as though some make them and have absolutely no intention of keeping them. You understand that wedding vows are a type of a promise. Until death is what I surmise most said, but it appears that fewer and fewer actually hold true to that promise. Our obedience to the gospel plan of salvation is a type of promise. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life, is what most were taught, but it would appear that fewer and fewer are holding true to their end of receiving that promise. Now, here's the point. What if God were to keep his promises like we oftentimes do? What if God suddenly changed his mind about forgiving our sins? What would we think about God? He's made the promises in the Bible. We meet our end of that condition. What's he going to do? He's going to keep his promise, wouldn't you say? Well, what if he decided, you know what, I'm tired of keeping my promises. Everybody else makes them and breaks them, so why can't I? We'd be in trouble, wouldn't we? What would we think about God if that's how he did us? What if God suddenly changed his mind about eternal life? What could we do about it? What are we going to do? Now think about this. To our benefit, and thankfully for us, God is not a man that he should lie. That's Bible language, Numbers 23:19. In fact, the Bible teaches in no less than two places that God cannot lie. Titus 1:2 and Hebrews 6:18. So when God makes a promise, we can rest assured that he will do his part. I think we understand this. Some of God's promises are without conditions. They are conditionless. Let me give you an example of a conditionless promise. It's called the rainbow. No matter how good we act or no matter how awful we act, God has made a promise that he will not destroy the entire world, the entire earth, again by water. No matter what we do or don't do, God is going to keep his promise because there are no conditions which we have to meet. Now, what about the promise of life? What about the promise, as we'll see tonight, of eternal life? Are there any conditions which we have to meet in order for God to keep his end of the promise of eternal life? Well, let's open our Bibles to 1 John chapter 5. And for the next little bit, we're going to talk about some of the promises in the New Testament. Tonight, we're going to talk about the promise of life. Let's look at 1 John chapter 5. Let's begin in verse 11, and let's read verse 11, verse 12, and verse 13. And then we're going to talk about these passages and others tonight, all in view of the promise of life. 1 John 5:11 says, this is the record, that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that ye have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Three things we want to suggest tonight, three things we're really going to answer. First, we're going to talk about the type of life. What type of life is under consideration here in 1 John 5, 11 through 13? Second, we're going to talk about the location of this type of life. Where can we find this promise of life that we just read about? And then third, we're going to talk about the conditions of life. How do we acquire and preserve this promise of life? Now, that's pretty simple. So that's what we intend to do tonight. Now let's begin. Let's talk in the first place about the type of life. Now, what promise of life is under consideration? Anybody who paid any attention at all, you can't miss it, right? But let's talk about it anyway. As used throughout Scripture, the word life has more than one meaning. Depending upon the context, life can refer to physical life. It can refer to spiritual life. And like most other words, life can be used literally. It can be used figuratively. All life ultimately goes back to the original life giver. We know him as Jehovah God Almighty. So all life, regardless of if it's literal, physical, figurative, whatever you want to say, all of it goes back to God. Now let me try to, I guess, mess you up just here a little bit and make you think just for a second. There is a sense in which we can be alive and dead at the same time. Now, if I were you, and I'd never heard that before in my life, you need to explain that. Good. I'm glad you asked that, because that's what I want to do. I want to explain, in view of the Scriptures, how we can be alive in one sense and yet dead in another. Let's start in 1 Timothy. Back up a little bit to 1 Timothy, and let's look at chapter 5 and verse number 6 of the book that we know as 1 Timothy. Let's see what the Bible says here. We're going to read a few other passages. And let's try to see what condition we're in right now. Because I can look up and tell that everybody in here, I'm pretty sure, as I look out, you're alive in one sense. Now, are you alive in another sense? I can't tell that from just looking at you. Now, look at 1 Timothy 5 and verse 6. But she, this is in the context even of widows, but she that liveth in pleasure, what is she? Is dead while she liveth. Now, if I don't read another passage, there is a sense in which a person can be alive and dead at the same time. We can be alive, walking around, breathing oxygen in the flesh, and be alive physically. But that's not the only sense of life in the Bible. This woman, in this context, was alive physically, but she was dead. Well, how was she dead? She was dead spiritually. Let me give you another passage to consider. Look back in the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. We'll read a few passages from Ephesians tonight, various contexts. Let's look at Ephesians 2 and verse 1. We're going to see essentially the same thing. Ephesians 2, 1 says, and you hath he quickened. I think some translations say he made you alive, who were dead in trespasses and sins. Well, he's already talking to people who were physically alive, so how had these people been dead? They had been dead spiritually. How were they dead spiritually? They were separated spiritually in trespasses and sins. Now, let me give you another passage to consider. We're going to work backwards, I guess. Look in the book of Luke, chapter 16. We all need to be familiar with this passage. We all need to read it to some of our lost friends from time to time and let them see the truth of what God teaches. What comes out of Jesus' mouth here in Luke 16, beginning in verse 19? Really the whole section of Scripture, but we're just going to look at verses 19 through 23. Verse 19 of Luke 16 says, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. He lived in obvious comfort, physically speaking, in his physical life. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores. Here's two men at this point. They're physically alive, right? All right. Verse 21, this is still with regard to Lazarus the beggar, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table, moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores, licked Lazarus' sores. And it came to pass, now watch, that the beggar died. He died physically, but we're going to see that he was alive spiritually. And not only was he alive spiritually, he was all right. He's going to be comforted. Came to pass that the beggar died. How did he die? In this instance, he died physically and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. So he's all right. The rich man also died. Well, how did he die? He died physically. Did he cease to exist? Oh, no, he did not. And was buried. The implication is that a great big scene was made, perhaps a week-long celebration of this rich man and his death. A big hoodoo, a big humdrum was made about this guy's death. And verse 23, in hell. Now that's obviously in direct contrast from Abraham's bosom. In hell, he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. So here we see two people dying. They both died physically. In one sense, both of them were alive in that they continued to exist. But you do realize that one was alive and had life in that he was comforted. The other one was alive, but he was not comforted. He was in obvious pain and in obvious torment. Turn back a few more pages to the book of Matthew. We're trying to embalm this in our minds. Look at Matthew 22. For the sake of time, we'll look at verses 29 through 33. But the Sadducees have come to try and trip up Jesus in his words. It seems that they almost made that their profession. That's what their goal in life apparently was to try and make an idiot out of Jesus. Well, do you think they succeeded? They didn't. They failed miserably on all accounts. They tried, the Sadducees, who didn't believe in the resurrection. They didn't believe in angels. They didn't believe in spirit. They didn't believe in, really, in life after death at all. They give an illustration, and if you would like to read it in verses 23 through 28, you can. But for the purpose of this sermon, look at verse 29 of Matthew 22. Jesus answered and said unto them, ye do err, not knowing the scriptures, number one, nor, number two, the power of God. For in the resurrection they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. Now look at verse 31. But as touching the resurrection of the dead, have ye not read? Do you realize how many times Jesus begged for people to say, have you read what the Bible teaches about what you're asking? Have ye not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, verse 32, I am. That's present tense from however you look at it. I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. Now that's very significant. It doesn't say I was the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. It says, I am. Now look, God is not the God of the dead. Now wait a minute. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob have been dead. Physically speaking, they had been dead for a long time, but yet I am. Present tense, right now when he said it. Still true to this very moment in time. Jehovah God is still the God of Abraham and of Isaac, and of Jacob, and they're dead. How can that be? Look, God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. Therefore, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were physically dead, but they're still alive. They're spiritually alive. Their soul, their spirit is continuing to exist. And do you think that they're with Lazarus, the beggar man, in Abraham's bosom, or do you think that they're with the rich man in torment? Well, obviously, they're not with the rich man in torment, are they? They're in Abraham's bosom. Now, here's the point. Life, as we're considering it, certainly means to exist, but it means more than that. Once we begin to exist, that is, once we are conceived in our mother's womb, we never cease to be. You understand that, don't you? We're different than any other creation that God has made. When we begin to exist, we will always exist. Now, we will not always exist in flesh and bone bodies. I think we do understand that. Therefore, life, as it is used in various contexts, means to be in fellowship with God. Since death means separation, I think most of us, most reasonable people can agree to that definition of death. Death is separation, whether it's physically, whether it's spiritually, however it is, it's not annihilation. So what would life be? It would be fellowship. It would be togetherness. It means to be pleasing to God. It means, life that is, means to be in harmony with His will and ultimately to be with God in eternity. Now, if we were to go back and look quickly at 1 John 5:11, what type of life was under consideration? Eternal life. That is existence after we die physically, But yet our soul, our spirit continues to exist. But continues to exist where and how? In Abraham's bosom, comforted from the trials and the tribulation of this life. The promise of life in 1 John 5:11 is eternal life. It is eternal spiritual life. Look in 1 John chapter 2. And notice the language of the Bible here, even from the book of 1 John. Look at 1 John 2 and verse number 25. In view of God's promise of life. 1 John 2:25 says, and this is the promise, that he hath promised us even what? Even eternal life. Friend, we're not going to live forever in these old flesh and bone bodies, but we can live forever somewhere. And from one aspect, we are going to continue to exist no matter where it is. We're going to try and make our best effort to be sure it's in comfort, to be in fellowship with God. But when these flesh and bone bodies give up, listen, we don't just cease to be. We keep on existing somewhere. Now, look at 1 John 5 and verse 11. Let's move on. Let's talk in the second place about the location of this life. Where can we find this promise of eternal life? Now look at what the verse says. It says, and this is the record, this is the testimony that God hath given, that's past tense, isn't it? Hath given to us eternal life. Now we understand the type of life under consideration now, surely fully. And this life is in his Son. Now since we are dealing with God's promise of spiritual life, eternal life, we must look for a spiritual location. Now, one thing which must be made clear is that the things we do or do not do in our outer man, that is our physical body, are accountable to our inner man. That would be our soul or our spirit. 1 John 5:11 plainly declares this life. Well, what life is under consideration? Eternal life is in his Son. Who is the Father's only begotten Son? Jesus Christ. Now, as used in various contexts throughout Scripture, the small, seemingly insignificant word in, that is I-N, has a very deep meaning. It has reference in the first place to a position regarding location. Now, where is eternal life? According to 1 John 5:11, this life is in. That is a position regarding location. It is in his Son. This word in, I-N, also refers to the closeness of the relationship needed to possess this life. Again, the text clearly tells us eternal life is in his Son. Now, let's consider just a few of the in Christ passages located in the book of Ephesians. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 1. And let's notice a few of these. The theme of the book of Ephesians is the church of Christ. Let's look at the very first verse. Let's notice this phrase, in Christ. Let's just try to look at a few of them in the first two chapters of Ephesians and see what we can determine. Ephesians 1 verse 1, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, to the saints, notice they were alive and in the flesh, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful. Well, where are these faithful? Where are these faithful? What does the Bible say? It says, to the faithful in. That's a position regarding location. It shows the closeness of this relationship. Well, where are they? They are in Christ Jesus. Now skip down to verse 3 of chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Well, what do you mean by in heavenly places? In heavenly places, in Christ. That is a position with regard to location. Look at chapter 2 and verse 6. We looked at verse 1 a little while ago. We'll now look at verse 6. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places. Well, what are these heavenly places? Where are they? In Christ Jesus. That's a position with regard to location. Look in this same chapter, but verse 13. Now notice what happens when we get in Christ Jesus. But now, not then, not later, but now, now in who? In Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh, and it tells us how we were brought close. How did we enter into this place? How did we enter into the closeness of this relationship? By the blood of Christ. In Christ, therefore, is the spiritual location of all spiritual blessings. That's exactly what Ephesians 1:3 told us, isn't it? Now, what does it mean to be in Christ? Just for the sake of time, I'm going to rattle these passages off, but you ought to read them. You ought to look at the things that are found in Christ, because according to 2 Timothy 2 and verse 10, salvation is in Christ Jesus. So to be saved, where does that mean I need to be, spiritually speaking? I need to be in Christ Jesus. You're aware that Acts 2:41 and verse 47, where are all the saved? They're in the church. Do you realize that? Read Acts 2:41. Read Acts 2:47. The baptized are the saved in verse 41. The saved are added somewhere in verse 47. Well, they're added to the church. So the baptized are the saved, and all the saved are added to the church. Now, what does it mean to be in the church? That means to be in the body of Christ. Look at 1 Corinthians 1 and verse 2. 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 27. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. You realize if you're saved, you're in the church. If you're in the church, you're in the body. If you're in the body, you're in the kingdom. Matthew 16, verses 18 and 19. Verse 18, Jesus promises to build my church. Verse 19, he promises Peter specifically to give him the keys of the kingdom. Well, what's the difference between the church and the kingdom? Nothing. It's the same spiritual location. Colossians 1 and verse 13. There were obviously people alive in the flesh in the first century, and they had been translated out of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. Brethren, friend, and neighbor, we need to know this. We need to know the type of life under consideration, but we need to know where to find it. The Bible is clear. This life is in his son. Eternal life is in Christ Jesus. That cannot be argued against. The Bible clearly teaches that. Now, we're dealing with spiritual life and obviously a spiritual location, but now third, let's talk about the conditions of this life. Go with me back to 1 John 5. Look with me now at 1 John 5 and verse number 12, because this gives us the conditions in its own way. 1 John 5:12 says, he that hath the Son, that's obviously Jesus, hath life. Well, what life is under consideration? Eternal life. And he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Now, what type of life is under consideration? Eternal life. Now, what in the world does it mean to hath or hath not the Son of God? To hath the Son, on the one hand, is to cherish and to treasure him. How do we do that? By totally and completely obeying him with all our heart. Hence, to hath the Son, what is that equal to? Because things equal to the same thing are equal to each other. To hath the Son is to be in Christ. No difference in meaning. What does it mean to hath the Son? It means to be in Christ. Now, since that is true, to hath not the Son is to despise and disregard him by disobeying what he is instructed in the New Testament. Now, let that sink in just for a second. Those, what did the verse say? Look at it. He that hath the Son hath life. Okay? Those who hath the Son hath life. What type of life? Eternal life. And the verse continues, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. Let that sink in. Those who hath not the Son of God hath not life. What type of life do they not have? They don't have eternal life. Now, do you realize that not everyone is pleasing to God? And since everyone is not pleasing to God, friend, everyone is not going to heaven. We can like it or we can lump it. That's Bible. That's thus saith the Lord. We can ignore it. We can try and avoid it. But it's in the Bible, isn't it? Now, these are clear and indisputable conditions for eternal life. We have to have the Son. You want to go to heaven? You want to have eternal life? You have to have the Son. What does that mean? In essence, boil it down, it means obey Him. Do what He says. Now let's consider quickly some New Testament passages and determine how we get into Christ and thereby have eternal life. Now, let's go to the book of Romans. Look with me in Romans chapter 10. Romans 10. Almost nobody argues with this that I know of. We're going to read Romans 10 verses 8, 9, and 10. I can't recall right offhand anybody arguing about these verses. But I'm going to make a point from these verses. Romans 10, beginning in verse 8. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Therefore, first, you got to be taught right. You got to hear the right message. Everybody agree with that? I think everybody. Yeah, you got to be taught right. Okay. Verse number 9, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Do we believe that? Yeah, we believe that. Notice how the expanded idea is given in verse 10. For with the heart, that's the Bible heart, the mind, man believeth. Now look at this, because I'm going to make a point from this moving forward. With the heart man believeth unto, that is, you're headed in the right direction. You believe the right message, you're headed in the right direction. Unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made. Now what does it say? It says unto, you're headed in the right direction, but you're not where you're trying to get yet. Do you see the words of the Bible? For with the heart man believeth unto, you're headed in the right direction, righteousness. And with the mouth, confession, that is, that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, confession is made unto, you're headed in the right direction, but you're not there yet, unto salvation. Now, I think we all understand what the Bible teaches in Acts 17:30. We understand that repentance is not optional, it is necessary, it is a command. It is required of all people. I don't know how else to say it. It's not optional. We have to repent of sin if we're going to try and have eternal life. So we're not even going to look at Acts 17:30. But I want you to notice the language of the Bible, specifically in Galatians 3, verses 26 and 27. What did Romans 10, 9 and 10 teach, specifically verse 10? With the heart man believeth unto, with the mouth confession is made unto, U-N-T-O. You're headed in the right direction, but you're not where you're trying to get. We're trying to get in, because eternal life is in His Son. How do I get into Christ? Galatians 3, 26 and 27. For you're all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. Now watch this. Look at the language of the Bible. For as many of you as have been baptized. He did not say believe. He did not say confess. He did not say repent. What did He say? For as many of you as have been baptized. He didn't say unto. What did He say? He said baptized into Christ. Have put on Christ. Now, if I were to ask you, you know, we read 1 John 5, 11, 12, 13, we read those passages and you say, yeah, eternal life is in His Son. How do I get in His Son? How do I get into Christ? It's not by belief only, is it? It's not by confession only, is it? It's not by repentance, is it? How do I get into Christ? In accordance with belief, repentance, and confession of Christ as the Son of God, baptism is where I get into Christ. All spiritual blessings are located where, brethren? In Christ. Is eternal life a spiritual blessing? Yes. 2 Timothy 2:10 says salvation is in Christ. I don't know how much plainer to make it, other than Acts 8:35 through 39. Let's read it. you're here. May as well read it. Perhaps I could quote it. Speed up the process. But it looks like and sounds like you're flipping with me, most of you. So we may as well read it and get it right. And see it with our own eyes and understanding before it's too late. Acts 8, beginning in verse 35, then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Notice, and as they went on their way, they came unto. Look at it. They came unto a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Verse 37 ought to be in your Bible. If it's not, you might not want to use that one. And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Look, watch. Verse 38. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both. They went down both. It does not say unto, does it? They came unto the water, but they came unto the water so that they could get into the water. Do you see it? They went down both into the water, two grown men, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. He immersed him in water. And when they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord called away Philip that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. Is that what somebody taught you how to get into Christ? Is that what you were taught? If you hadn't read that before now, would you have thought you had the promise of life? Do you have the promise of life? You don't have the promise of life, eternal life, if you're not in Christ. That's not Brock's doctrine. That's Bible doctrine. That is New Testament gospel. That is what the Bible teaches. Well, there's the conditions. Now, how do we stay right? There's how we get right. How do we stay right? Look at Acts 8, verse 22, the same chapter. Here's a person who was baptized into Christ, and yet he sinned after he was in Christ. So what do we have to do when we're in Christ? We've been added to the church. What happens when we sin? Acts 8, 22. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness and pray. There's when you pray. When? After you've been added to the Lord's church, you've been baptized into Christ. Well, what happens when we sin? Now's the time to pray. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness and pray God if perhaps the thought of thine heart may be forgiven thee. 1 John 1, 9. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Now go with me back to 1 John very quickly because I want to make a strong point, I think. We looked at verse 11, didn't we?
Yeah.
We looked at verse 12, didn't we?
Yeah.
Now let me show you what verse 13 teaches. Every person in here can know, K-N-O-W, whether you're right or wrong. Are you right? Are you in Christ? Or are you not? You don't have to guess. You can know it. 1 John 5:13, these things have I written. Why is the Bible written? These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life. Well, if I know that I have eternal life, then I can also know that I don't have eternal life. Do you have eternal life? Look at it. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life and that ye may believe. The idea is continue believing, continue obeying on the name of the Son of God. You know, despite meaning well, many times promises are broken, aren't they? Promises are broken by those many times who we love the most. So I want to assure you and remind you of one thing. Know this, God keeps his promises. He upholds what he said he would do to the letter, not almost all the way. God is not hit and miss. God grants eternal life. Don't you see this? God grants eternal life to all those who obey his conditions of pardon. I ask you politely, but very seriously, do you know that you have eternal life? Let's make certain. Let me give you God's test of honesty one more time, because it might be the last time I get to tell you, and it might be the last time you ever hear it. You got to hear that gospel, Acts 18, 8. You got to believe that gospel, Acts 16, 31. Repent of sin, Acts 17, 30. Confess openly and freely that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, Acts 8, 37. Now watch. All those things get you unto. You're headed in the right direction, but you got to obey Acts 2, 38. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Did not Galatians 3:27 says that's where we get into Christ? So if you've not been baptized for the remission of sins, what's the conclusion? You're not in Christ. After you obey that, the Lord has added you to his church. Acts 2:47, Romans 16:16. What do we need to do, brethren, by and large? What happens when we sin? Acts 8:22, repent and pray. Wherever you are, come now. As together we stand, and as we sing the song of encouragement.
Have you been?